John Wayne just jumps at the camera,
yeah,
throwing himself to the ground, shotgun style, and we cut away, and the duel is out of frame.
You love that stuff.
It's amazing. I love that stuff.
Yes, hello and welcome to Pod Hard. My name is Jonas Högberg.
Yeah, hello and welcome to Pod Hard. My name is Anders Hultqvist.
Yeah, we can swap each other's intros out here. Maybe we can do them in sync. That would be something awesome, special, groovy. yeah, we're adopting our broadest American accents because today we are watching a Western. All right.
Yeah, we've been neglecting the Western genre since day one. And now we're up to snuff.
Well, I did talk a bit about the Atomics movie. A teeny, teeny bit of Western we've managed to squeeze in. But yeah, generally we've been...
A faint whiff.
We've been piss poor with the Western. But this is about to change as... The coming weeks will be all about Westerns. We're doing three Westerns from 1939. Wow, what a year, apparently. And today we're watching that day-old classic, or how you call it. We're watching Stagecoach, one of the great movies. One of the great Westerns, I believe, many Western aficionados would say.
Yeah, and this one is also on my list of shame.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I haven't seen
it. Well, okay, this is a bit strange because I know we saw Stagecoach in film school. Maybe you were absent that day.
Yeah, maybe I blinked and missed it.
Maybe you blinked and maybe you slept through the movie. I don't know. But that's where I saw it the first time.
Okay.
Everybody talked about, oh, yeah, all of these characters in the movies... They're these typical basic stock characters that you can use and switch around. You have the boozy doctor. You have the upper class twitty lady. And you have, the whore with the heart of gold. And we have the rogue outlaw that is just so dashing and... Fantastic. Basically, this is like the first time they like smashed all of these characters together and got some kind of a morality tale out of it. I mean, all of the people back in the day thought were swell people, that is, people with high and upstanding professions, like a banker. All of those dudes, they're douchebags. And all of the outlaws and, more clandestine characters, they were the heroes of the story. So this is going to be some interesting flick, man.
And it's the one, all the old-timey classic... stunt geezers wish they had been in or done the big stunt. So that's the Pod Hard appeal.
Yeah, this episode we're going to talk about the legend that is Yakima Canutt. Perhaps the greatest or at least most famous stunt coordinator of all time. So yeah, we're having a doozy of an episode in front of us, Anders.
Let's jump in.
Let's do it. And with that, we're back, everybody. We've seen Stagecoach. Anders, was that to your liking? Do you feel that you've exercised your demons regarding this movie?
Did I have demons regarding it? You know, initially I was gonna be like the negative, oh man, it's oversimplified and obvious. But you know, I got pulled in. It's great stuff.
Yeah, I think so too, actually.
I mean, there's an efficiency to the directing and the writing here, and all the actors are doing their parts, and it just moves along at a... It just...
At a?
Like a clockwork.
At a pace.
No, no.
Ah, like a clockwork. There we have it. The new thing for you to say. Yeah, and we talked about this during the movie that we saw that Orson Welles had seen this movie like 40 to 60 times before he directed Citizen Kane, his first movie, and that he thought that Stagecoach was like his film school, that he learned everything about the craft from this, from simply watching this movie, how to edit the movie, how to make sure all the scenes has a purpose, to make sure that everything moves at the pace. apparently all you need to do really is to watch Stagecoach and you'll make films.
Yeah, so when you hear stuff like that, that's when I usually want to be the what's
the crank.
Yeah. The crank. Yeah.
the curmudgeon.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. But I really like that. I got swept away. And I mean, it's such a great build-up. First, there's a long build-up to... If we take it from an action point of view, there's a long build-up to a really great set piece. And then there's an even better build-up towards the end.
Okay. To a very small set piece, yeah. A set piece that is not even shown, or not that much of it.
I was going to get to that.
Yeah, well, we'll get to that. Let's start from the beginning, like we usually do.
But I didn't make any notes or any stuff because it is. I mean,
you were mesmerized.
No, but what is there for Pod Hard to say? It's it's a well-made movie. I mean, there's.
It is a well-made movie. I
can only talk about the weird little offshoots and oddities, and this is just it is what it is set out to do, more or less.
Well, can I talk a bit about John Ford and John Wayne before we get into the movie?
You can talk about whatever you want.
Oh, okay. Wow, you're being very generous now.
Amuse me, dear sir.
Well, this was a sort of a pet project for John Ford. I mean, he directed like silent westerns in the 20s, but then during all of the 30s, he was like out of the western genre. And then he felt like, yeah, let's sort of re-energize the western. I mean, before Stagecoach and some other movies from 39, there was lots of westerns in 1939. Not only those we're going to see, but a lot of other stuff as well. And all of them sort of re-energized the genre. And before, in the 30s, westerns had been like B-movies. No one really wanted to see them. They were considered a lesser genre. Maybe because it was more focused on action and stuff like that. And nobody really digged the vibe of the Western, of the Wild West anymore. John Ford wanted to bring it back and give some new energy to it.
And, I mean, the genre had been around for decades already, so...
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
So maybe a bit fatigued.
I mean, some would say that the first ever real... the first feature movie was The Great Train Robbery, a Western, so yeah. Of course, Western is as old as it gets. And I mean, the Wild West was still happening back when movies were made for the first time back in the 1890s. So, and I mean, Tom Mix, who we talked about a bit earlier, he and John Ford were like best buds with Wyatt Earp, who was like a consultant on a lot of silent westerns. So yeah, the old western heroes and stars that were actually in the Wild West, they were a big part of the early western movies. And that brings us to John Wayne, the dude who was originally named Marion Morrison. I mean, can you imagine being called Marion Morrison? That's not a butch, classic, hardcore name.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah, I do like it as well. And he was nicknamed the Duke after his own dog. He used to walk around on the streets as a 10-year-old. With his dog, and there was someone that saw him that was like, oh, there's little Duke out with Duke. And so he was called Duke. Well, John Wayne, he got a break as a prop boy and an extra via Tom Mix in the 20s. And later on, he got the chance as the lead in Raoul Walsh's The Big Trail in 1930. That movie was like it was like box office poison. And so John Wayne had to endure in the swamp of the B-movie westerns for the rest of the 30s, up until 1939, when he was given the chance in Stagecoach. John Ford had always had a keen eye for Wayne. And Wayne had, during this time, been buddies with Yakima Canutt, the famous stunt coordinator for this movie. And apparently John Wayne sort of based a lot of his persona upon Yakima Canutt, who was the real deal. He was a rodeo star that also was a minor silent star in the 20s. But when movies turned to talkies, he couldn't be in front of the camera anymore. Not with his face and say things.
He had a very special voice, didn't he?
Yeah, apparently he said himself that he talked like a hillbilly in a well, which begs the question, wow, I want to hear him talk. That sounds amazing. But apparently John Wayne based a lot of his own talking in westerns upon Yakima Canutt. So we can actually listen to John Wayne and see a lot of Yakima Canutt in him. John Wayne's famous walking almost is almost like a drawl. It's almost like he's drawling his walking. And that was Yakima Canutt as well. But not only did Yakima Canutt give John Wayne everything, he also was a big part of how Western's action sequences was changed. Of course, he became a stuntman in the 30s, and during the end of the 30s, he started doing like stunt coordinating. I don't think it was called stunt coordinator in that time, but he was essentially doing stunt coordinating, sort of like telling the director, oh, we should do it like this. And you should have the camera at this angle to capture the action in the best way, in the best frame. And Yakima Canutt and John Wayne apparently also invented like fisticuffs for movies as well, which is very interesting for Pod Hard. But we didn't actually see any fisticuffs in this movie. That was a drag, of course. but we'll get to that, I think, in the 40s. It's the classic, you know, angle where you're like positioned like behind someone and you see someone clobber the other person, but you don't get that sort of depth of field. So you get tricked into thinking that they connect with their fists. So that was all Yakima Canutt. And he also did a lot of horse riding and horse stunts. And I guess we'll get into that as we talk about Stagecoach in more in detail. But that's my setup for it. Now let's get into the bits and parts and nooks.
Into the stagecoach.
Let's get into the stagecoach, because that's sort of like the first thing happening, man.
Yeah, a couple of people getting into a stagecoach, roaming about.
Yeah, a couple of geezers.
Yeah, there's some different character types. I guess a slice of society or something.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, a drunk doctor. Yeah, everybody, what are they? You said, you already said it in the...
Yeah, in the pre-talk. I mean, you got the prostitute with the heart of gold. You got the
Dallas.
Dirty, rotten banker. You got the card shark gambler. I don't know if the whiskey salesman actually was sort of a character that was used, but this meek, very... afraid character, I guess that was a...
You mean Mr. Meek?
Yeah, Mr. Meek. I mean, this dude is actually played by Donald Meek. His name implies what he plays. It's fantastic. And I have to say, Donald Meek, he's like the highlight of the movie almost. He's great. All these little nuances in his acting. He's so fantastic. Fantastically comical in everything he does. I love him.
I knew you'd like that that geezer.
Yeah, he's a grade A geezer, man. And another another geezer.
So it's a 4 out of 5.
Yeah, that's
on the geezer.
That's
meter.
A 4 out of 5 geezer. Almost 5. And
almost 5 on the geezer meter.
I don't know,
folks. You heard it here first.
The alcoholic
stagecoach.
The alcoholic doctor is of course another geezer. And the scene it all stage driver. I think he's a bit younger though, but. He's gonna get into geezer territory very soon. He's also great, played by Andy Devine, if I'm not mistaken. He's the stagecoach. He's great. He screams when he talks, and he's always got this.
I mean, he can't. He can't hold a tone, so he's in his teens always.
He's a very shrill voice. It's always breaking apart.
Sounds great, man.
And there's a lot of cutaway images of him riding the stagecoach and like berating his horses. And shouting to the marshal who's riding shotgun with him. And all of those... I'm always happy when they cut away to him and he's like... Great stuff.
But it's a really cute love story at heart here as well between the kid and Dallas, the so-called fallen woman.
Yeah.
They accept each other... although, society doesn't.
Yeah, exactly.
Kind of nice.
And I mean,
and they spoiler alert, do get to get a happy ending as well.
Yeah, I'm guessing they weren't big on what you call them, sad endings in the 30s. So I don't think it was that weird that westerns had a happy
no,
ending
but,
back
but,
then.
No, but I was thinking that she would get killed or something because of her background. That is usually how it goes in later days, it seems. Thumbs up.
Yeah, I mean, there's like it's like an inverted morality place almost. Yeah, morality piece almost. I mean, all of the fallen characters, they're great and.
Yeah, treated like humans.
They're treated like humans, absolutely. And it all works out for them. So that's great. But all of these fantastic characters, they gather in this stagecoach. And we're given some small exposition. There's like a couple of dudes in a like... in a fort, talking to an Indian. Was it like a Mojave Indian or anyway? They warn that the Apaches are on the war path, and they get a telegraph note that has one name written on it, Geronimo. So everybody is taken aback, aghast. Oh, oh no, what to do, what to do? And the stagecoach is gonna go straight through this war. So, oops.
Yeah, some tension.
Tension building for ya.
Yeah, that's a good thing for an action movie. Tension.
And there's a lot of tension between the characters as well.
Yeah, yeah.
So, yeah.
Stuff is going on.
Stuff is
they
going on.
They are dilly-dallying and
no, we're
going off at each other.
We're dilly-dallying, man. We're always dilly-dallying.
So they go off at each other and they go off at the sunset and they go off at different things.
You soon get the picture. John Ford loves Monumental Valley. This is the first...
Hey, man. This place looks amazing.
And I get it, yeah.
Have you been there?
No, I never been there. I think it's like in Arizona. I'm guessing now. I haven't looked it up, but... yeah, it's supposedly a beautiful, beautiful place, and this was the first time Ford filmed it, and he fell in love with it, as you can see, because he reuses a lot of the, not the same images, but he like films the stagecoach in various parts of the valley with these giant domes of rock in the background.
Yeah, but that first big shot of the coach going across the landscape and we see this in the background stretching out. I mean, damn, I was almost like, it almost like looks unreal.
Yeah, you were thinking CGI, like green screen, right?
Yeah, it's a green screen. No, but it's a great use of environment.
Is this early animation, man? What's happening? Is this Avatar? This is not Earth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, so there's a lot of these images, and we get a lot of stagecoach riding. They meet up with the Ringo kid, and we get a great introduction to John Wayne as an action hero. John Ford has this dolly shot where the camera is pushing in as he is doing he's loading his shotgun. Nowadays we would say Arnold Schwarzenegger style, but yeah, it was John Wayne who did it first. Well, I don't know if he did it first, but he was the one who made it famous, of course.
Yeah, it's an iconic shot.
Yeah, it's an iconic shot. And I love when the camera...
Doesn't matter if someone did it before because he blew it away.
Yeah, totally. And I mean, the camera...
Shotgun style.
The camera goes straight up into his face, almost like a Sergio Leone close-up. And
so you got a little bit wet.
Yeah, I was a bit, ooh la la, now we're talking. And I love his... the way his eyes are moving in this close-up, he's scanning the environment, and he's not the classic action hero, all swagger and style. He seems a bit nervous, actually. So there's a lot of nuances here as well.
He's pretty gentle. I mean, yeah, he's got a gentle touch.
Absolutely. And I mean, we've talked a bit about these action heroes, how they're always douchebags. up until now, almost. John Wayne is really a gentleman with the ladies. And I guess you have to see Westerns to get that, I guess. In all other movies we've seen, they're always douchebags, so all the dudes. And we can't figure out why are the ladies interested in these... persons.
Yeah, nice seeing someone treating women as human beings.
Yeah, great stuff. Ringo Kid, he plays Ringo Kid, and Ringo Kid is on the lam. He's escaped from prison. The marshal, he says that he'll put him in jail, but he's also heading for this town, the stagecoach final destination, because that's where he will duel with the man who killed his brother. So he's on a revenge mission. And the marshal, he sort of likes Ringo Kid. And he feels that he should put him back in jail because that would be best for him. He would probably get killed in the fight against these hoodlums in Lordstown, I think the city is called. So there's a lot of dueling emotions here. But for the meantime, Ringo the Kid gets a seat in the stagecoach and we're off again.
Yeah, so it's a little tightly knitted chamber play.
Yeah.
Going to another tight place. They arrive at, what's it called? A place?
A haberdash.
A fort? A haberdash.
That's what I was taught in The Hateful Eight, the Quentin Tarantino movie that is obviously sort of like an homage to Stagecoach.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. And haberdash.
A haberdash. Let's call it a haberdash.
Yes. So more chamber play stuff.
Yeah.
Going about. Yeah. And slowly we start to build up to the big set piece.
Yes. We get some more of these scenes where Ringo the Kid and Dallas is like, they're like the pariah. And everybody else wants to sit far away from them at the dinner table. And the posh lady, she gives birth to a daughter. And everybody is like, oh, yeah. Ooh, blah, 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 blah. And the doctor needs to sober up. And there's a lot of character stuff going on in these haberdashes. I think there's like two haberdashes. then finally we're on the road.
Two haberdashes.
Finally, we get some cowboys and Indians. It's a pretty spectacular set piece, man.
It's a big ass set piece. Some great camera placement here. I liked when they go before it all breaks out. They go over a river with a stagecoach. And there was the camera was shooting up above from the roof. It was pretty cool. And then in the big chase scene, there's this low angle from the side of the stagecoach that was really intense stuff.
Mm, almost like ground filming with the camera.
Like in a car chase.
Yeah.
So many great shots here.
Yeah, and the stagecoach and all of the attacking Apache Indians, they're really punishing their horses. They're going top speed here. That's evident. So that's an added bonus to the action.
Yeah, lots of horse falls here.
It really feels like it's high stakes here. If you fall off, you might die.
And there's these great shots where you really feel that there are so many people involved. It's a really mass. It's this mass scene going on. There's a great the shot where the kid jumps down from the stagecoach and jumps between the horses. You see all these horses in the background riding around, and really cool.
Yeah.
Shots.
Yeah, you almost feel like, what? Is this done with a green screen? This looks awesome. But that was done for real. And it was, of course, Yakima Canutt who doubled John Wayne here, jumping from horse to horse.
He is a Canutt.
Yeah, he's a Canutt. And it was also Canutt who who doubled an Indian, the Indian who jumps from his horse to the stagecoach horses. Gets shot by John Wayne and drops to the ground, appears to be trampled by all of the horses, and goes under the stagecoach. And the camera follows him all the way. It's a great shot.
It's the big stunt.
Yeah, it's a fantastic stunt. I mean, it looks dangerous as hell. And Yakima Canutt has talked about this stunt in great detail. He did it a lot of times in different movies. This is, of course, the most famous, but there's like 5 movies where he's done this stunt. This was like his specialty. And he always talked about you really needed the horses to go at full speed, because if they were like running at like a lower speed, they would not be as controlled in their forward motion. They could like run to the side a bit. So it was really...
Yeah, they gotta go in a straight line.
Yeah, they really needed to go to in a straight line for him to be able to pass through them under the stagecoach and then be free of the potential trampling. So yeah, and he really needed to jut in his arms and elbows and shoulders and all that. So it was a lot of technique going into this stunt, of course. And you can actually see when the camera follows Canutt that he almost gets up after the stunt. He's supposed to be dead, like, but it seems like, oh yeah, I really did it. Oh man.
Yeah, he gets shot 2 times, but I mean, he could get up and stumble about and die.
Yeah, I guess.
Later, I think it works.
But it looks sort of funny. But yeah, I can understand him, and at the same time, you really want to see, oh man, did I just pass through all that? Oh my crap! And
I'm alive.
And when he went up to John Ford and asked if they had gotten it on camera and if he needed to do the stunt again, John Ford said, "I don't know if we got it. I don't care. I don't ever want to do that again." So, yeah, there was a lot riding on this one, I guess.
So apparently it's the same with the falling technique. For horses, they have to go at a certain speed to not get hurt.
Oh, are you thinking about the running W manager maneuver?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I think so too. You talked a bit about, I mean, obviously Yakima Canutt invented this technique where you like have a wire and you pull the wire and you make the horses fall to the ground to get some cool shots.
I think
shots.
It was an old Mexican technique to rile up horses that were running.
Okay.
I've been listening, and I recommend everyone to listen to the Stunt Pod, where they interview old stunt geezers.
Nice.
New stunt geezers as well. Legendary stuntmen and younger talents. It's just great. But they talked a bit about these horse stunts. That if you, I think it has to be made at a certain speed as well, and then the horse just tumble and doesn't hurt itself. Canutt supposedly made over 300 horse stunts and never hurt a horse.
Oh,
so they
wow.
were more worried about the stuntmen.
Okay.
So the stuntmen could get underneath the
horses.
Oh
yeah, of
and,
course.
And stuff. So that was the more dangerous. Supposedly there was a Western later that filmed a stunt at too slow and the horse died, and they kept it in the movie.
Ooh.
And there was an outcry. Okay. But I don't remember the title of this movie.
Well,
so that's when they changed a lot.
I mean, we've talked about the running W maneuver earlier in Pod Hard. We talked a bit about it in our Swashbuckler special. I believe there was a lot of horses being killed in the Crusade of the Light Brigades, or whatever it's called.
Yeah, yeah. Curtis didn't care much about anything.
I mean, it's obvious Canutt wasn't on the set for that movie. If it's what you say, that he never hurt a horse, he really knew his stuff.
I don't know if that's true, but I mean, these were horse guys.
Mm.
He was most famous for being into horse stunts and stuff, and maybe there's some respect between them, or maybe I'm wrong.
Well, there was sort of like I know that they like introduced a code for treating animals better in like 1940s that needed to treat animals better while making movies. So that's when a lot of horses were saved, I guess, from these lesser stunt coordinators pulling the running W gag, as they say in the business. And they actually banned the running W stunt in the 80s, I think. It was actually that late. And it's a fantastic set piece. We lose a couple of characters here. Only one character actually dies. It's the card shark gambler. And there's a great shot, man. When it appears to be that everything is like doomed for these guys. The Indians are too many. They're about to die, everybody. And they're running out of bullets. And the card shark dude has only one bullet left in his gun. And he has been smitten a bit with the lady that gave birth earlier. And he thinks, oh, I should kill her now and make sure she doesn't fall into the hands of the Apaches. And so he positions his gun at her head. And we only see her face and his hand holding the gun. And then we hear a shot and we see his hand and his gun falling away. And she is still in the frame looking away. And then she hears the cavalry, the trumpet of the cavalry. And she realizes, oh, we're saved. But doesn't realize herself that she was saved just a couple of seconds earlier by Apache shot, I guess. That shot Hatfield, the card shark. So yeah, pretty great stuff, actually. He uses framing and imagery and the timing a lot to great effect in his shots, John Ford.
I agree.
Great. So we finally roll into town to our final destination. And we are setting up for the classic Western duel, man.
Yeah, and it's a long setup.
Yeah.
With many different small acts. Yeah, it's just a show-off in directing, I suppose. You mentioned Sergio Leone earlier. I was thinking he is also a master at build-up. Mm. So
yeah.
Did you get the feel here as well?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I love how he cuts between characters. We follow Ringo Kid and Dallas as they're walking through town. Dallas is sort of finally telling Ringo the Kid that she's a prostitute by showing him to her quarters, or the part of town where she resides. And as he realizes, he doesn't care. He's a good guy with a good heart, and he's fallen in love with her. He doesn't care. John Ford is intercutting these scenes with the bad guys at the saloon.
And yeah, the plumbers.
And these guys are on edge, man.
There's some great scenes at the bar where they're getting ready.
Yeah. You talked about the pianist.
And yeah, the pianist who's playing dramatic. The music isn't that dramatic, but he's playing it like he's building up.
Yeah.
And later, when they're at the bar and the other two arrive, there's this wonderful scene without music. There's just a wonderful play with silence in this scene. That is both it builds tension and then there's this awkward silences as well. Just really funny and put a great use.
Yeah, this...
At other parts, I think the music is a bit obnoxious.
As it always is
you know,
in these
you know
movies.
So the silence here maybe works even better because the music in the scene just before is a bit obnoxious. So the silence is really welcome.
Yeah, there, and so. All of the music, greatly modulated. All of the music in the saloon is diegetic music by the pianist. So that falls into the mood building.
There was a part of the music I really liked. There's when they're out in the sandstorm early.
Mm, yeah.
The strings are emulating the harsh winds.
Mm, yeah.
And almost go for some psycho style. Wee wee wee. I really like that. That part.
Yeah. Well, I guess Bernard Herrmann was working in the 30s. He must have been. Because he was pretty old when he did like the Psycho soundtrack and stuff like that. But I haven't actually... I mean, it's not him doing the music for Stagecoach, but maybe someone was inspired somewhere by something. Who knows?
Someone. Who knows? Who knows these things?
We're just a couple of geezers sitting here, everybody.
We probably could have read up on everything about this.
But I mean, it reminds
that's not our style.
It reminds me, there's a couple of great geezers as the Stagecoach is coming into town. They're screaming to each other, "Hey, it's the Ringo Kid!" Great geezer delivery there.
They run and tell the plumber.
The plumber.
The plumber.
Yeah, the plumbers, the bad guys. I mean, Luke Plumber, the main bad guy who killed Ringo the Kid's brother.
He's a big log of a man.
Yeah, big log of a man. And he almost doesn't say anything. I mean, he says a couple of lines at the end as he's about to go out from the saloon. But he just sort of emulates his emotions with his eyes and his body language. Which is a nice choice from Ford.
And I mean, they have, throughout the movie, they have talked about this, hinting at this duel, probably, that it will come. And I was afraid, maybe they skip it, they just talk about it, hyping it up, and don't do anything with it. And then we get this, this build-up is, it's a chef's kiss. there's so many details and things going on, and it's just perfectly orchestrated, I would say. And then when it's time for the duel, John Wayne just jumps at the camera, throwing himself to the ground shotgun style, and we cut away and the duel is out of frame.
You love that stuff.
It's amazing. I love that stuff.
I know.
The art of set, staging action scenes out of frame is one of my... I don't know. I just love it.
Yeah, I mean, you got it.
I mean, if all action movies were that, it would be a bit disappointing.
Absolutely, but we've gotten a great set piece just a couple of minutes before this, so we're not, starving for action. We've just had a long, fantastic action piece. So it's great to see John Ford building to another action piece. And then just have the balls to like, you're not getting it.
Amazing.
But yeah, it's a very nice shot as he's jumping towards the camera. He's jumping towards the ground and the fires a shot. And then poof, it's dark. And then we cut.
Yeah, cool as hell.
And then we cut away to Dallas, I think it is, who hears the shot and thinks Ringo has been killed. But
pow, pow, pow.
I mean, he's John Wayne. He escapes. He shoots the bad guys and they ride off, not into the sunset, I think. They're riding into the opposite. The sunrise.
The sunrise. The
sunrise. yeah.
They ride into the opposite.
Ah, because the fight has taken place during night. So there's a lot of shadow played going on as they're walking towards each other. The plumbers and
the
Ringo the Kid. Yeah, great shadows. Michael Curtis was seeing this and going, yes, I approve.
Okay,
I approve.
It's Michael Curtis approved and Geezer approved.
Stagecoach got it all.
It's a Podhard approved action classic.
It is. Oh yeah, and did you see Donald Meek and the Boosie Doctor? They had a great relationship. I mean, the Boosie Doctor, of course, loves Donald Meek's character, Peacock, because he's a whiskey salesman and has a lot of like samples that he's traveling with. So the Doctor sort of very kindly, but very forcefully becomes buds with this very Meek character played by Donald Meek. And there's a couple of great scenes between these geezers. One of these, I mean, first of all, when Donald Meek picks out his Sherlock Holmes hat and puts it on while they're riding in the stagecoach, I was like shrieking with joy. It was a fantastic sight.
Yeah, you're weak for the hats.
I'm weak for the hats, man. But it got even better, man. Later on, there's a scene where the Doctor is wiping away the tears, Donald Meek's tears, with his own handkerchief. It was spitting out water. Great. Oh, fantastic. Love these dudes. Love these geezers.